Babylon.
Oh, there is one of the Masonic symbols. And as you can see, you have a triangle, the unholy trinity of the devil. And you have the eternal circle, the satanic boast that he will reign forever. And there you have Jah, meaning Jehovah. Mm. But in an unholy mixture, he's mixed with the bull, you might say, or Baal. And the Bible mentions that Baal is indeed a fire, one of the ancient Canaanite fire gods, which is the devil. And then you have On, or On, which is the name of a city in Egypt wherein they worshipped the great sun god. And of course, his eye, his all-seeing eye, is on our dollar bill.
Yes.
So how did that get there? Well, there's, you know, another story behind that. Well,
we're going to get to all of that.
This is the Tau sign.
Go to the next shot there.
And here again, we have, this is the highest sign of Royal Arch Freemasonry. Well, now there we have something that would appear to be from the Bible, because the Old Testament talks about the serpent being put upon a cross and anyone who looked upon it was healed. But of course, in the occult, then they make the serpent to be holy.
Yes, they do. They're in their own works.
In their own works. And that's why the cover of my book, Codex Magica, has this Ouroboros serpent swallowing his own tail, which maybe we can talk about. Hey, here you've got an image of Aleister Crowley, the great, I call him great, he was really infamous, right. A British Satanist. And you know, L. Ron Hubbard went and studied under this British Satanist and founded Scientology. But here, look at the symbols of his hands and the radiant sun with a triangle on the headgear. Absolutely a Satanist. He would carve satanic images in the breast and the chest area of his women. He had a harem. And of course, he was also a bisexual, so he had males who he had sexual rituals with as well. These are all hideous emblems that bring in the male phallic symbol and all kinds of things.
They seem to worship that a lot.
Well, they do. Basically, all of these cults are sex cults. Because the mystery religions, they go back to the mystery religions, and they're related to that, and they're all sex cults. They had the goddess, remember, they had the holy prostitutes in the temple, and all of these are throwbacks to those kinds of things. What we're seeing there underneath the Jabulon symbol, underneath is a 3x3 ceremony in one of the Masonic rituals, and basically they do their hands and legs in such a way that literally it forms 666 when you get to various numerological configurations.
I found a lot of 666s, and this leads us to Albert Pike here.
A little bust of Albert Pike. If you go visit the House of the Temple, and they do have tours in Washington, D.C.
I've been there.
Oh, have you been there? Okay, I've never been there. I have many pictures of it. And it's exactly 13 blocks from the White House. Albert Pike was a Confederate war general. Now, in Texas, the NAACP and other agencies are demanding that we take down any monuments or statues having anything to do with the Confederacy. You know, if your school is named Robert E. Lee High School, change it. We want no vestiges of the old Confederacy. But isn't it interesting that Jesse Jackson, who's a 33rd degree Mason, Colin Powell, who's a 33rd degree Mason, have no problem with this man we saw, not this picture, but the one before, the bust of Albert Pike, who was a Confederate war general, who was wanted as a war criminal by Abraham Lincoln. And his statue today sits in front of the Justice Department in Washington, D.C., on public land, taken care of by the U.S. Park Service.
Right.
And he's a 33rd degree Mason, a Confederate war general, a war criminal.
And a Kabbalist.
Exactly. And so, but it's amazing. His tomb, meaning his body, is interred, the bones, inside the House of the Temple.
Yes.
The international headquarters of Scottish Rite Freemasonry in Washington, D.C.
She told me, she says, now, this place is haunted.
Oh, it's haunted.
And I said, I'm not surprised.
Oh, yeah.
They took me around and they brought me to the Albert Pike room.
Oh, uh-huh.
Now, they had told me, you're not allowed to be alone anywhere, right? Well, She left us alone there. And she's like, I'll be right back. Who's your grandfather? And she went and got my grandfather's membership card and then gave me a copy of Morals and Dogma and the glossary to Morals and Dogma.
Well, I'll be.
And, you know, they found out that my family were all related.
Yeah, and they thought you, well, this guy could be one of us. You had
go back to it real quick.
Yeah, you had a picture of Karl Marx.
Hey, I want to talk a little about the beard, you know. We've got Albert Pike and the beard.
Oh, yes.
Now we got Karl Marx doing the whole secret sign of
the beard. Of course, you know, many bearded men out there will get angry at us, and I don't mean to cast any aspersions on bearded men, but it is true that back in the 1800s, a satanic sect began, and one of the signs of it was heavy beards like this. It was often called the League of Just Men, but of course, they were not just at all. They were evil Satan worshipers, and Karl Marx was indeed a satanic priest. Now you see him here with his right hand in the coat. He is giving the hidden hand of the sign of Jabulon. Yeah. So that shows that he knew that the false god he worshipped was not God at all. He was Jewish, of course. His father, his grandfather, had been a Jewish rabbi, but he renounced even that faith and then became a Satanist. And in one of his early, he also tried to become a poet, but he wasn't very successful. But in Olanam, one of his early poems, he said his real goal was to destroy the whole world.
These people have
destroy the whole world. Yeah, they do.
And these pictures, now, they're set up as portraits. I mean, these are pictures that they intend to be shown and represent them.
You're right. You're right. That was like an official portrait of Karl Marx. But, you know, isn't it interesting? If you ask 10 people on the street that you choose, what does that hand sign signify there in the coat?
No,
they wouldn't know. So, again, they believe that they are, they get some kind of a satanic advantage. By the way, one of the reasons for these various hand signs is that they believe it invokes or invites satanic deities to come from another dimension. And it gives them energy powers. For they worship indeed the God of forces, the Bible says. The God of forces.
I'm trying to keep moving.
Sure, let's keep moving. Okay.
No, that's great. Talk all you want. So these hand signs go back to ancient Egypt.
They really do. Egypt, Babylon, you're going to see many of the signs and many of the... this is Christopher Columbus. He was a member, of course, of a secret Illuminati order. You notice the Knights Templar crosses in many of the paintings of the three ships that he brought over. But was his name really Christopher Columbus? No, it was not.
No.
And so there's a lot of secret history involved in all of these hand signs. And such too, Freeman.
My belief is that they've taken on the name Columbia. You know, that's our goddess.
This
is the male representation of Columbia.
You know, this is the first time I've ever heard that said in public, but I believe it is true. District of Columbia, as you mentioned, the nation of Columbia. Mm-hmm. And we have a if anybody would like to see her picture, maybe, I don't think it's a good representation, but we have Columbia Movie Studios.
Yes.
You know, the gal with the Roman toga, and she's has a torch, you know, that she's holding up and such.
Well, I set you up here a little clip here.
Okay.
Says, you know, the hook 'em horn sign. Now, this one, you know, people say, I love you, or, you know, they say it means so many things, but... It has always been something that rock and rollers use and always been in connection with Satan.
It has. At first, when you had the really deep, back in the 80s, early 90s especially, and 70s, the heavy metal satanic rock people, you know, that's when it really began. And Ozzy Osbourne, I remember one of the concerts, I never went to him, but I read that he actually had an altar call for the devil.
Yeah.
And said, come forward and worship the devil and give your life to the devil. And all the kids would be doing this kind of sign. Now, I look at an ignorance factor here.
Right.
And I give people, you know, I'm not saying that everybody that does that sign is a Satanist. And, of course, what we just saw was the University of Texas sign. The Longhorn sign. And I'm not at all impugning the integrity of Texas Longhorn fans. I'm one myself. But, again... Here again, we have a sign that can be used for good, just to indicate the Texas Longhorn football team, or for evil.
Well, open witchcraft. I mean, we practice witchcraft openly these days. Roll this clip here, Shag.
We have Matthew McConaughey,
A&M
for A&M.
I need some thought here.
You got to put a lot of thought into this hex because it's really powerful, or we wouldn't be up here doing this with these red candles, right? We don't even like red.
The tradition of the hex, lighting a red candle, goes back to the 1940s. The truth is,
A&M was killing UT for a number of years in a row, and a couple of students decided to go to a palm reader.
So they hired a local witch to put a hex on.
She said light red candles and keep them burning.
And we broke their curse in their undefeated season, 21-0.
Ever since then, Texas kicked the crap out of A&M.
And on this 64th anniversary of Madam Hipple's spell, these hexers mean business.
Now here what we've seen then, Freeman, and you have captured it on film, is indeed an occult ceremony. Now, they may say it's all for good and fun, and that's what the Shriners who make an oath to Muhammad and Allah, they may say, oh, we don't really mean it, it's all good fun and everything. But I wonder what God looks upon lighting red candles and doing hexes, saying we want to kill our opponent.
Yes.
And then even the longhorn sign, maybe when you combine all those things together, I wouldn't think that would be invoking good forces. Let's just put it that way.
I was not raised with a religion at all. But I have conclusively proven to myself that Satan rules this planet.
Mm-hmm.
So many things. I've done the corporate logos. I've looked into Columbia and her connections to Lucifer. All of these things show me constantly that our leaders are Satanists.
Now, what you've said is a cardinal principle. The Bible itself says Satan is God, with a small g now, of this world.
Right.
Temporarily, for whatever reason, God is allowing him to reign. The book of Revelation says he's furious because he knows he has but a short time. But you are right, and the signs are everywhere, but people don't know it. That's interesting because you say you're not a Christian, and yet you're more aware than 99.999 go out to the infinity of the Christians that I talk to. I don't know of any pastor that knows what you know about these things. That our culture is permeated with satanic symbols, signs, images, and doctrines. And yet the average pastor out there is saying, give us money and you'll get rich, and just into the most, in a way, they're in a form of black magic themselves.
Yes.
The average pastor. Or think positive, make positive confessions. None of these things having anything to do with true Christianity, but a lot to do with New Age occultism.
Yes.
So we're finding that. And of course, I'm a Christian myself. There is a true Christianity amidst all of the dense forest of false gods and worship. By the way, we're seeing a lot of symbols here. This is the Eastern Star.
Yeah, it's not just the men, it's the women.
Yeah, there's a women's group, and you see the satanic pentagram. The two points indicate the horn, horns of the devil, pointing upward there. Anytime you see a pentagon in the middle, that again is a an occultic symbol, and it makes you think about the great war god Mars. It's one of the symbols of the war god Mars. And what is the pentagon at Washington, D.C.? In the shape of? Well, of course, a pentagon and the god of Mars, or the god of war, which is Mars. By the way, Laura Bush is not a UT graduate, but I just saw her there giving
the kids too.
Yeah, the kids too. Yeah. One of the daughters, of course, is a UT graduate, but the mother, well, no. And I've even seen the senior Barbara Bush, you know, the eminence lady, seen her giving that sign as well.
Britney Spears giving the sign.
Yeah, now
we'll come back to her.
Okay, we'll come back to that. And notice that her, in this case, it's the satanic sign, but there's the thumb sticking out.
Yes,
too.
That's.
And many people say, well, that's not the sign of Satan, then. That's the death signing of I love you, but actually, that's not always
Helen
true.
Keller in a cult also?
Helen Keller was one of the ones who helped to formulate and bring the American Society for the Deaf signs to the fore. But she was also an occultist. She was a theosophist, a Swedenborgian, and I believe that's the reason why that sign. Does it mean I love you, or does it mean I love you, devil?
Yeah.
That's the question.
That is the question. Now, these people, they act as if they're here to help us, and they put themselves into placements to where they can pretend to help us.
Yeah, oh, well. Yeah, here's the keeping the faith. That's an interesting. There's a communist fist. keeping the faith and what? Communism, evidently, according to this Black Power salute type of a fist there, it seems.
Well, they give us their hand signs, you know. Mm-hmm. We're going to get into the peace sign in a minute. And they give it to us, and everybody thinks that, you know, they came up with it. All of a sudden, it's their sign of solidarity.
Yes.
But now
yes.
Look at these few pictures here.